Hello. My name is Bishop Tanya Rawls, and I am founder and executive director, co-director now, fortunately, of the Freedom Center for Social Justice, and also pastor of Sacred Souls Community Church. The Reverend Dr. William Barber II is pastor of Greenleaf Christian Church in Goldsboro, North Carolina, and architect of the Forward Together Moral Movement that gained national acclaim with its Moral Monday protests in North Carolina's General Assembly in 2013. These weekly actions drew tens of thousands of North Carolinians and other moral witnesses to the state legislature. More than 1,050 of us, peaceful protesters, were arrested, handcuffed, and jailed as we fought for the rights and protections of queer folk, trans people, the poor, workers, reproductive justice groups, immigrants, and people of color. A highly sought after speaker, he has keynoted hundreds of national and state conferences. Some of you may also recall his iconic speech at last year's Democratic National Convention. It was there that he stated that America had a heart problem and needed a moral defibrillator to shock us toward a more just society. Dr. Barber has served as president of the North Carolina NAACP, the largest state conference in the South. In 2016, he also sits on the National Board of Directors for the NAACP as well. He's a former Mel King Fellow at MIT, and he's currently visiting professor of public theology and activism at Union Theological Seminary in New York, and is a senior fellow at Auburn Seminary. He has two recent books, one titled Forward Together, and his second book is The Third Reconstruction. That's his bio, but I want to tell you a little bit about the man. For more than 25 years, I have worked at the intersection of faith and race and class and gender identity and orientation. And I've learned something from that seat. In particular, I have learned the characteristics of many of the great change agents in our society. I learned first that they have an uncanny ability to see and seize a moment. They are able to feel the needs of others and focus not just on the work within their communities, but to expand their vision broader. They masterfully build bridges that become gateways to transformation. They're willing to lose something in the fight because they understand that most people will never understand in the moment the bigness of what we are sitting in. And oftentimes what people fear or misunderstand, they seek to destroy. They are also able to hold on to integrity when in rooms where values of others are not necessarily totally aligned with theirs, but they hold on to their core principles. They're able to draw resources to their cause and are okay allowing others to aid in the management of that. And lastly, they inspire us. William J. Barber II is one such man. He has stood for gay and trans rights in North Carolina and the nation when others cowered, even those within the LGBT community. He has lost friends, he has lost members in his congregation and his movement, but he has not faltered in his willingness to say, no longer can we separate these movements, no longer can we separate the work that we all do together. This work does not always have a public face, but I can assure you this is a man who works ceaselessly for all of our good. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., whose life we celebrated on Monday, was one such man. And we typically only get one every generation or so. Well, I want to suggest that the man that is about to follow, the Reverend Dr. William J. Barber, is a man for our times. Let us welcome him.
It doesn't matter if you love him Capital H-I-M-M-M-M-M-M. Just put your paws off.
Good evening. Before Reverend Barber comes, I'm Yara Allen, and I'm with the For It Together Moral Movement in North Carolina. I'm going to ask you if you would stand again, if you would grab the hand of the person next to you. And I want you to share in heart and in spirit these words. The higher you build your barriers, the taller I'll become. The farther you take my rights away, the faster I will run. You can't deny me. You can't decide to turn your face away. The more they refuse to hear your voice, the louder you should sing. They're hiding behind walls of Jericho. Their lies will come tumbling. Deny my place in time. You squander wealth that's mine. My light will shine so brightly because there's something inside so strong. Put your hands together. I know that I can make it. Though you're doing me wrong, so wrong. Thought that my pride was gone. Oh no. There's something inside so strong. Oh, something inside so strong. Can you raise your voice on that part? There's something inside so strong. I know that I can make it. Though you're doing me wrong, so wrong. You thought that my pride was gone, but oh no. There's something inside so strong. Oh, something inside so strong.
Welcome, Reverend Barber.
It's time to create some change in America. I'm glad to be here with all of you tonight as we gather in this space, recognizing that we are indeed the ones that we've been looking for. Thank you for this humbling opportunity. I want to lift a passage of scripture, one line from Psalms 118 that says, the stones that the builders rejected have now become the chief cornerstones. And tonight, I want to talk about when the stones come together. And I want to start with three stories about three stones or three people that have changed my life. Every time I go to jail, I pray, and when I pray, I ask God, what would you have me to do? And the first person I want to talk about is when I went to jail with Reverend Nancy Petty, whom I believe is an angel described as a Baptist preacher. Several years ago, I was getting ready for bed about 11:30 a.m., and I was quite despondent because we could not seem to get people, even some clergy, to rally in support of children in Wake County, where the resegregationists were trying to take over. I picked up the paper late one night before going to bed, and I read a beautiful letter to the editor of the Raleigh News and Observer, and it was signed simply Nancy Petty. She wrote that she was the mother of two kids in Wake County schools, and that she agreed completely with something I had said at one of the mass meetings, protesting the far rights or far wrongs effort to resegregate Wake County's nationally acclaimed diverse school assignment policies. I don't know what led me that late night to read the letter, pick up the paper at 11:30 at night, but I can remember clearly that it revived my spirit and made my heart overflow. I had the crazy idea around 12 o'clock that night that I would call Miss Petty and tell her how much the letter meant to me. And so that night I called Nancy. And we had a wonderful talk, and we set up a meeting to talk some more. Well, it turned out that Nancy Petty had left out of her letter two important facts about herself. Besides being a mother, she was Reverend Nancy Petty. And that night we did not talk sexuality, we talked children and what mattered for all children. It was only later, actually, when somebody was criticizing us, standing together, trying to be ugly. We had just come out of jail, and one of the extremists printed an article saying, uh-oh, Wake County's going to hell because the big black preacher and the gay lesbian white minister are working together. And so I saw it, and I said, so you're gay? She said, so you're black? I said, we became close friends and jailbirds together twice. But it wasn't based on politics, it was based on the soul and a kind of camaraderie that forms when you fight for justice together. Her directness, her honesty, her steadfast support of anti-racism, anti-poverty movement that we call Forward Together movement in North Carolina, historic thousands on Jones Street, we had been building for 6 years. And she's been a great source now in the 11th year. I invited her to speak to one of our moral marches on Raleigh. She invited me to come preach at Pullen. I then invited her to preach at Greenleaf. And when the national and local far-wrong millionaires came up with their scheme of buying four Wake County board seats in order to try to resegregate the schools, we stood together. We went through epiphanies together. We showed what can happen even in the South. Now, we didn't come together, as some in the media said, when the Amendment 1 fight came to North Carolina. We were already together. And we learned the Tea Party, so-called Republicans, had decided to put up a bill to vote that had been drafted by some of the national extremists to make same-sex marriage unconstitutional in North Carolina. We didn't have to come together. We were already together. And so we were able to stand. I counseled and prayed with Sister Nancy and many others. Equality North Carolina and its many friends geared up for what we all knew was going to be a fight. And they invited me as a preacher and as the NAACP president to come and preach to a gathering similar to this one, to ideas. And I wrote an open letter that year outlining why we were against the marriage amendment proposal. And there, I met a second stone, a second person that changed my life. I don't know his name. Actually, that night I wasn't feeling well. I had just come from surgery, but I had to speak that night. And so during the course of the speech, my sugar was going up and down because I was recently from surgery, but I felt so called to stand and speak on behalf of the LGBT community. And I never will forget when I came off stage, a young gay man was standing in the corner, and as I approached him, he began to tremble. And when I got close enough, I said, "Son, what's wrong?" He said, "I've never been this close to a minister and not feared for my existence." I cried. I said, "Never, son, never again." He cried on my shoulder. He thanked me that a minister would even see him as a fellow human being, which I thought was so pathetic and so problematic and such a bad character for those who claim to walk around in the cloth. Yeah. They would cause a young person that kind of hurt. But we were learning that what had been knots began to come apart easily just by pulling the strings of justice and love and humility. And so the story continues. The national far wrong sent their paid organizers to North Carolina to stir up votes in favor of Amendment 1, but we stuck together. We stuck together on matters of conscience. We stuck together on matters of morality, on matters of the Constitution. We declared that no member of any minority can afford to permit a majority vote to be taken to allow the government to decide our fundamental human rights. Never. And we had faith, but since we had seen it happen many times in our struggle, that if we worked hard and stuck to our strong moral and constitutional position, we could reach the minds and the hearts of thousands of voters. But we didn't win that vote, but we won something bigger, a deeper connection. It was during that time as we fought that President Obama came out. Some like to believe some of that was because of what was happening in a southern state, in North Carolina. I was firmly convinced that we had done the right thing. And so after talking to scores of disappointed, disillusioned, fearful people, after the vote, I could feel their isolation. I could feel their fear. So I met with some of our national board members. And on May 19th, the NAACP Chairman Brock asked me as president of the North Carolina NAACP and chair of the National Political Action Committee to present in closed session what we had learned, the lessons we had learned in our struggle in North Carolina, because we had had my good friend in California, Alice Huffman, had been fighting. But there had never been a southern state, a southern chapter of the NAACP, a southern unit that was willing to take on this stance. And so we took it on. And while I was testifying, I thought of my sister Nancy. I thought of the young man. I thought of all of you, known and unknown. And I said this to the board. The question regarding the equality of rights for the LGBT community and our citizens and same-sex couple is not a question for Black America. It's a question for America itself. When we say we the people, when we say equal protection under the law for all people, the question is, does that mean only those whom we agree with personally and religiously? Do we mean some people and not others? And if this is the case, then we render the noble sentiments of our democracy and the lofty language of inclusion to be painfully hypocritical. I then said to them, the reality is that when you examine the voting records and the public policy positions carefully, the same forces that are fighting us on voting rights and education equality and economic justice and addressing racial disparities in the criminal justice system are the same ones behind the attacks on the LGBTQ community. I reminded them that this was not a new position for us. The NAACP has always opposed any custom, tradition, practice, law, or constitutional amendment that denies any right to any persons. And I also reminded them that for the most part in America, the only time we passed constitutional amendment was to broaden the cover of the Constitution, not to lessen it. And then I said to the board, I said, we must be clear and say with one voice that those who think that the sons and daughters of the civil rights movement can't see through their Trojan horse trick when they try to use wedge issues to seduce us to be a part of their scheme to deny the LGBTQ citizen fundamental rights must be crazy. We know exactly what you're up to. And after 30 minutes in closed session, late on the afternoon of May 19th, the 64-member board of the National NAACP debated what Julian Bond had been putting before us for years and passed a strong resolution to support equal rights for gay marriages. And I know what was in it because I wrote it. I wrote it and made the motion, wrote it on the back of a white napkin, and had the privilege of conferring with Julian Bond, made the motion, and it went like this. I so move, Madam Chair, that the NAACP's constitutionally, affirmatively states our objective to ensure political, educational, social, and economic equality of all people. Therefore, the NAACP has opposed and will continue to oppose any national, state, local policy, or legislative initiative that seeks to codify discrimination or hatred into the law or to remove the constitutional right of the LGBTQ community citizen. We support marriage equality consistent with equal protection under the law provided by the 14th Amendment of the United States of the Constitution. I so move. And when the vote was taken, when it was passed, I felt a great joy. We all felt a great joy. It loosed our leaders to go on the front line. I knew it was a historical moment for America. Another lesson we must learn, particularly progressives and liberals, is not to throw away the high moral ground and walk away from religious discourse. We cannot assume that the majority of people who confess faith do so along the same criteria as the ultra-conservative so-called religious right evangelical. The truth of you is, you all might be shocked, but I need to let you know something. I am a theologically evangelical, conservative, liberal, liberationist, charismatic biblicist. In other words, I am a person of faith, and I'm here to stand with you because my faith tells me that love is the ultimate virtue of faith. In fact, I have a question for those who try to weaponize religion and use Jesus and use the Bible as a blunt tool to hit over the head of people who are different. I want to know why they say so much about what God says so little and so little about what God says so much. There are thousands upon thousands of scriptures about poverty and justice and how you treat the poor and how you treat the least of these and how you treat the unaccepted. Where is your voice on this issue? But then, after the marriage amendment fight in North Carolina, we experienced a major regressive onslaught. The first 50 days in 2013, through cheating and through gerrymandering, an extremist body won the legislature and the governor. First 50 days, they attacked everything. They were extremism on steroids. They cut 900,000 people's earned income tax credit. They cut 180,000 people's unemployment. They denied 500,000 people Medicaid expansion, meaning thousands of people would die. They attacked public education. They attacked the immigrant community. They attacked the LGBT community. And then during Easter season, they attacked voting rights. And it was then, April 29th, that Moral Monday began. 17 of us went in, 7 preachers, 10 others, and we were standing up for justice, and they told us to arrest us. They even arrested one lady who had cerebral palsy that was in a wheelchair. And it was in the middle of Moral Monday that I met Bishop Tanya Rawls, who so graciously introduced me tonight. I didn't meet her first, though, at a rally for the LGBT community. I met her when we were having a rally about voting rights. And since then, she has taught me the struggles of being a woman, a lesbian, a pastor, and an African American. And I've preached at her church and loved on all the people, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer. And she's been at my church, and we've been together, recognizing that all of these issues intersect. She's been together with us on the fight for health care, for voting rights. In fact, sometimes Bishop Rawls and I'll play a trick on them, the adversaries. She'll get up and announce that she's a black, gay, lesbian, married, same-sex married person, but she's come to the podium to talk about voting rights. I'll get up and say, I'm a black, straight man, and I've come to talk about the LGBT community. And the point is, you're not going to separate us anymore. In fact, that's what we're in a fight for now. We've got this HB2 bill that's in North Carolina. It was Tanya Rawls that helped us understand. Bishop Rawls said, look, we can't let them play us. Because you know that whole bill is a setup, right? They said it's a bathroom bill. And they said it was about the LGBTQ community, hoping that they could use that as a wedge and nobody would read the rest of the bill. See, actually, the bill is about the LGBT and the transgender community. But the bill also makes it so that cities and counties can't raise their wages to a living wage. It also says that if a county is building, say, a stadium, they can't require the contractors to pay a living wage. That same bill also says that even if you're a straight person or a veteran or you're disabled, that you no longer have access to state courts to bring an employment discrimination case. But they were trying to use the transgender community, and they were trying to what we call bait and switch. And what we said was, hell no. That's what we said. Well, some of us might have said heaven no. But anyway, either way. And that's why now we are saying across the country, and the NAACP in North Carolina is getting ready to vote this coming weekend to send a request up to national, because what we're saying is you shouldn't just boycott North Carolina because of how HB2 affected the transgender community. You should sue that, and you should boycott them because the bill affects the poor working community. You should boycott them because the bill is an anti-union, anti-labor, anti-living wage, it's a pro-discrimination bill. In fact, we ought to boycott North Carolina because they have gerrymandered the districts, which keeps allowing us to elect extremist candidates. You ought to boycott them because even though we won the governorship, they have now moved to take the power from the government to appoint people and to appoint local boards of election. In other words, you ought to boycott North Carolina because when you attack the LGBT community and you attack voting rights and you attack labor, you attack us all, and we're all going to stand together. This brings me to a second point. You see, in every moment, our activism must be rooted in deep analysis. Touch your neighbor and say, deep analysis. Deep analysis. Even in this inaugural moment, we must probe what has happened. God bless you. We must probe what has happened. We cannot just be mad. We cannot just curse. I believe in this particular moment, I've seen some major rejections, and we've got to work through those major rejections. You all make sure you fight the right people, because I'm your friend. rejected statesmanship for slick performance. We've rejected real answers for lies and propaganda. We've seen a rejection of deep moral values for justice. And we've seen them take over for heresy in the white evangelicalism. We've rejected objective media for a media circus. We've rejected dealing with racism for fear and normalization of bigotry in the political process. And early Wednesday morning, November the 9th, after running a campaign that was enthusiastically endorsed by the KKK, Donald Trump thanked his supporters and his victory and promised to be president for all Americans, a shock to almost every pollster and political pundit. His victory has been heralded as an unprecedented political upheaval. But the reactionary wave that swept across America this past Tuesday is not an anomaly in our history. It is indeed an all too familiar pattern in the long struggle for American Reconstruction. And we have to probe this. Anyone who watched the election returns come on television Tuesday night will remember that red band that stretched from my home state of North Carolina, southwest across the nation, the former Confederate states. This solid South proved to be a reliable base for Trump. But he joins a long line of white men who have leveraged this base to get to the White House. The truth is, this is not America's first time electing a racist, fearful president. He has distorted the truth about economic fears. There's an article entitled, "With a Snarl, Trump Ratifies His Supporters' Rage." And Sarah Sobrajia is an associate professor of sociology at Tufts University. And she says, for a constituency that feels misunderstood and resentful, politically silenced by critics who deem their views racist, sexist, homophobic, or simply problematic, Trump proffers dignity, voice, and visibility without shame. He says loud things his supporters have been scorned for thinking. Kimmel, another author, says what you see happening is a grieved entitlement. He points out economic fears, but he points the problem to the wrong people. He blames it on black people, on the LGBT community, on Muslims, on the immigrants. The truth is, we do have real economic fears. In 10 of the country's poorest states are Southern. In those 10 states, we still are red states that elect people who vote against the very program that would help the poor. We do live in an America where 400 families make $97,000 an hour while we are arresting people for 15. We do live in that kind of America. There is real struggle, but the problem is not the black people or the LGBT community or Muslims or immigrants, but it's a wealthy, greedy oligarchy that wants to run this nation. Donald Trump's unanticipated victory. According to Neil Painter, a scholar at Princeton, Donald Trump's unanticipated victory could not have been possible without the election of President Obama. Listen, let's probe it. When he told America, or white Americans, many, that he was their last chance to make America great again, he was touching a wound passed down since the lost cause of religion of the 19th century. She wrote an article August 9, 2016, and she said this before the election: as nasty as Donald Trump gets, his poll numbers stay strong. Why are so many of his followers so mean-spirited? Here is the iconography of a tragic, traditionally American call and response. The call, a challenge to the status quo of white people on top. The response, outbreaks of meanness, many merely vile, embracing rhetorical weapons, many murderers taking up physical weapons, the bloody history of lynching with its festive mobs and populism and souvenir postcards and body parts. Like so many things in America's racial history, the solid South was born of compromise. Confederate states were readmitted based on their affirmation of the Reconstruction Amendment, but it took federal troops to hold on to them. You have to know the history of 1876, when Southern politicians developed the Mississippi Plan to make America great again. You gotta know this history. They came up with a plan to take back their country by any means necessary. And through voter suppression and intimidation and violence, they swept the South in 1876. but they gained the presidency in 1877. It was the first time that one of the first times when a president lost the popular vote by a large margin, but was selected by the Electoral College with a promise that if he was selected, he would use his government to pull power to remove federal troops from the South so that the poor former slave owners could take back the South and they could roll back the civil rights legislation that had been passed in 1875. We have to do a deep probe. It was after President Harry Truman embraced civil rights that Southern Democrats formed their own segregationist states' rights Dixie Party in 1948. After the Supreme Court ordered an end to segregation in Brown versus Board of Education, there came massive resistance and the murder of Emmett Till. The same kind of backlash followed the victories in the civil rights movement when black and brown and gay people and union people came together to do what was called the Second Reconstruction. We won the Civil Rights Act, the Voting Rights Act, the Fair Housing Act. There was a decade of struggle waged by people who knew they might never see the victory in their own lifetime. And then there was a backlash called the Southern Strategy. Richard Nixon started talking about law and order. But before him, George Wallace ran a campaign in 1968. And if you read George Wallace's speech in Madison Square Garden, 1968, and put beside his speech a stump speech of Trump, it's almost the same speech. I know, because I've done it. The same anti-movement, anti-people, fear-mongering is in that speech. Richard Nixon was told by Kevin Phillips, though, you can't be as vocal and as racist in your language as George Wallace, but if you can find out who hates who and pit them against each other, you can use those wedge issues to win. But you've got to use new language to talk about race. You can't say the N-word, so you say things like tax cuts and entitlement reform. And the 14th Amendment is an infringement on the South, and the 15th Amendment is an infringement on the South. And we saw this, and then it was finally used to its fullest when Ronald Reagan in 1980 hooked up with the homophobic moral majority, went to Philadelphia, Mississippi, where Swanna, Cheney, and Goodman were killed, and right down the street at the fair, he announced his presidency, his candidacy in the South for the presidency of the United States. And he used all the tools of the Southern Strategy and won a landslide election. Another writer puts it like this, and this is Nell Painter, and another writer says, listen, more than simply change, Obama's election felt like inversion to many people. And Robin DiAngelo calls it white fragility. She says that is a state in which a minimum amount of racial stress becomes intolerable. And here's what we have going on now. Because we have not had in this country a grown-up transformative dealing with the issue of race, what my grandma used to call grown folks talk. See, racism is not whether you call somebody the N-word or whether you denounce David Dukes. That's easy to do. You know, racism is not asking Senator Sessions, does he have any black friends? Jesse Helms had black friends. Strom Thurmond had a black woman, had a black baby, but that didn't have nothing to do with him passing racist policy. Can y'all hear me now? Huh? See, the grown-up question about race is, for instance, in the most unreported story of this election cycle. We went through 25 debates and did not have one debate, Republican, Democrat, on voting rights. And the fact that the Voting Rights Amendment has been disassembled 50 years after its passing, and that we've seen the worst voting suppression method since Jim Crow. The most underreported story is that there were 868 less voting places in the black community than there were in 2012. We've seen more voter suppression than we've seen since Jim Crow. It affected thousands of people, and 17 states passed new voter suppression laws in this country since Shelby. So long before the Russians hacked, and they did hack, America's electoral system had been hacked by fear and racism and voter suppression. And we've got to deal with that. That's the grown-up conversation about race. And it has to be a conversation that Black, white, Latino, and LGBTQ people have. The other part of that is, if there are 8 million more poor white people than there are poor Black people, and 5 million more poor white people than there are Latinos, then how is it in the states where we have the poorest that they are voting for the candidates who pass policies that hurt poor people the most? What trumps common sense? That's a serious question in America. And then the last thing we've got to probe. I know people have talked about Michigan and Ohio, but I'm old Southern boy. So let me say something. If you can control the 13 former Confederate states, from North Carolina to Texas, you control 171 electoral votes. You control 31% of the United States House of Representatives, and you control 26 senators, which means you only need 25 from the other 37 states. You only need 20% of the House of Representatives from the other 37 states, and you only need 99 electoral votes from the other 37 states. If you can find a formula that creates a wedge issues to lock up the South, if you understand that, you understand why, particularly in the South, you have these issues about LGBT community and race constantly being fed into the body politic, because the goal is these 171 electoral votes, these 31% of the House of Representatives, the 26 members of the United States Senate. Because if you give anybody a 171 vote head start in a race to 270, I'll take that bet any day. But they also know that the flip side is true now, that if you register 30% of the unregistered Black voters in the South, and they connect with white progressive whites and Latinos and the LGBT community, then states like Virginia, North Carolina, Georgia, Texas, and Florida become states you can change. And if you change the South, you change the nation. That's why we've got to work together. And we've got to know who our enemies are and who they're not. And that's why you got to have some preachers that will go after this weaponized religion. I saw this statement today. He wasn't even a preacher. The actor, Boosie, I think his name is, saying God answered our prayers. That Abraham Lincoln was smiling, and we've got to challenge so-called white evangelicalism. That is not, where Jim Wallace, who's a white evangelical, says he's an evangelical. He doesn't use the word white because he said when you put white in front of evangelical, that's hypocrisy, that's heresy. There's no such thing as white evangelicalism. The white becomes a euphemism for folk that want to use evangelicalism as a cover for their racism and everything else. The fact of the matter is, the word evangelical in the Bible starts with a critique of poverty and systems of poverty. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he hath anointed me to preach good news. That's evangelical, good news, evangelical, to the poor. So anybody who claims to be a person of faith, but then they do not pass and help promote policies that cares about the poor, the brokenhearted, the prisoners, the blind, the least of these, the sick, and those who have been made unaccepted, they are engaging in theological malpractice and heresy, and we have to take it on. And so, as I move toward conclusion, America, we cannot waste our time asking how could this have happened. It happened because it's a habit deep within our public memory. That's what happened in this election. And if we are willing to see ourselves as we are and as we have been, we can also see our potential for prophetic resistance in times like these. We don't have to ultimately be in despair. There are signs that the world of Trumpism doesn't have the last word. You remember how I told you about Bishop Rawls and Nancy and the young man I met? But down in North Carolina, we built a moral fusion movement and had a moral framework. We came together in the South. We stayed together in the South. We went to jail together in the South. We went to court together in the South. Now, we didn't win immediately, but we stayed together. And this past November, on election day, Trumpism came to North Carolina. He won slightly, but he couldn't drill down because we had a movement there. And the extremists lost the governor's race, the AG's race, the auditor's race, the secretary of state's race. And an African-American judge won 76 counties by over 350,000 votes, proving that we can organize in the South. We can organize in the South. We can organize across this nation. And you can organize when you engage in indigenously led grassroots organizing, not waiting for helicopter leadership. You can organize when you use moral language, not red versus blue, that's too puny. Not left versus right, because I got left and right hand. But moral language. When you demonstrate a commitment to civil disobedience that follows an agenda, not just being mad. When you build a stage from which to lift the voices of everyday people, not politicians, that are impacted by immoral politics. When you recognize the centrality of racism in America and you refuse to let people make you think it's race or class. The fact is, when somebody asks me, is it race or is it class, I simply say, it is. But you also got to add what Coretta Scott King said, that racism, homophobia, xenophobia, and classism all have the same goal, dehumanization of creations of God, creators. Or we can organize. We got to build a broad, diverse coalition of all religious leaders of all faith and people not of faith but who believe in the deep moral constitutional values. We must intentionally diversify the movement and win unlikely allies. We must build transformative long-term coalitions, not where you come in the coalition till you win your bill and then you leave, but where we understand we must all win some things together. When it comes to economic sustainability, addressing poverty, health care for all, educational equity, criminal justice reform, expanding and protecting voting rights, and never backing up on the equal protection under the law, regardless of your race, your color, your creed, or your sexuality, all of those issues intersect, and we stand as one together to fight together. Then we must make a serious commitment to academic and empirical analysis of policy, because there's nothing wrong, nothing worse than being loud and wrong. You gotta make sure when you talk, you got a footnote. And number 10, we must utilize social media, coordination and often video, text, Twitter, Facebook, because the mainstream outlets often are unable to tell a story that does not fit into their corporate narrative. Number 11, we've got to engage voter registration and voter education, the political power of fusion, not popular movement, but fusion coalition is based on a diversified electorate. Number 12, we got to pursue a strong legal strategy, because any movement you have in the street, you got to get it in the courts. Because if you're standing up against it in the street, then you have to have the Constitution to say it's unconstitutional in the courts. Then we must engage the cultural arts, whether it's singing or spoken word or storytelling or visual art, because we're only as strong as our imagination is together. And then we must resist the one-moment mentality. We must build a movement. No one rally is going to usher in the beloved community. No single setback ought to frustrate us. We have to build a movement and not just have moments. And so, my friends, we are in difficult times. And after that Tuesday, rejection of justice, which is as American as apple pie, now we must apply the moral defibrillators to our own hearts. Put your hand on your heart. And you must now be determined to stand for love and justice and mercy more than ever. You can take less than a majority of Americans elected a mortal, not a god, to be our president. You don't have to bow down at the tower. And you were not unelected. The Constitution was not unelected, and our power to come together was not unelected. We have to now focus on the beloved community, not just the Democratic Republic, but the beloved community. It's immoral to attack and demean people in word and policy. It's immoral to hurt people who are already hurting. It's immoral to use your power to reject me. It's immoral for you to have power. You get elected, for instance, to the Congress, and you get free health care simply because you got elected. And then you want to use the power you have to make sure that the people that elected you can't have the same thing you have. There's some things that are not about conservative versus liberal or Democrat versus Republican. They are about what's right and what's wrong. And in this moment, we have to focus on the beloved community. That's what kept people fighting in the past. That's what kept people fighting even when slavery looked them in the face. That's what kept people fighting long before there was the Supreme Court ruled on same-sex marriage. They kept their focus on the beloved community. And they fought even though they knew they might lose at first. But they knew if they raised the moral standard, they would either win now or they would sow the seeds for victories later. And there are moments in history that you must look yourself in the mirror and declare, I was born for this moment. And then we must fight for the beloved community. We can't stand down. No, there can be no standing down. Not now. We have to stand up for the hurting. We can't stand down in the face of immoral power. We can't put our head in the sand and wait till another 4 years. We have to fight for voting rights. Fight for equal protection under law. Fight for health care. Fight for environmental justice. Fight for educational equity. Fight for criminal justice reform. Fight for economic sustainability. We must never believe that poverty must be. And we must say to America, we will not let America sing, God shed his grace on you, unless there is grace for the poor, the immigrant, the gay, and everybody that's a part of God's humanity. And then finally, we must not only must we focus on the beloved community, and not only must we fight for the beloved community, we must feel the power of the beloved community. The same people who fight us are the same people. Same people. Same people that fight policies for the LGBT community are the same people that fight against voting rights. Same people. The same people who fight to have a police state are the same people that fight the legitimate discontent of Black Lives Matter, are the same people that fight our gay brothers and sisters. Same people. So the question is, if they are cynical enough to be together, we ought to be smart enough to stay together. And we got to watch them now. We got to watch them because they're shrewd. You see, Trump will try to pull spoke out. He'll say, I'm supportive of the LGBT community. But then he'll appoint an attorney general who's anti-voting rights and anti-gay. The goal is to play games with us in order to split us, because I have a sneaky feeling that they know the power of us together. And now is the time. Could it be that Donald Trump has been right about one thing? Yeah, maybe. You know, because a broke clock is right twice a day. Yeah. Could it be that he was right when he said at the end of his campaign to the extremists, I'm your last chance? Could he have been right that the demographics are changing? And what if he and his allies recognized that the only way they could win was they had to hack, cheat, lie, spin, and abuse? And I recognize that the only reason you cheat folk is because you can't beat them in a straight-up game. So what if he's really scared that change is coming? And what if all his and his allies have done is they have created a context that's going to force the rejected to come together? What if we, black, brown, gay, straight, young, old, Democrats, Republicans, those who believe in right, refuse to be isolated? I say we try it. I say let's try staying together. Let's try standing together, because the stone that the builders rejected can become the chief cornerstone. Can I just preach? I feel a little preaching in now. In other words, God can use the rejected to push a revival. And I know that there's some in this room who've known rejection. Rejection because of your sexuality. Rejection because of who you love. Rejection because of how you were born. Rejection because somebody needed somebody to hate to try to feel good about themselves. There are folk in this room that have known rejection. Do I have a witness? Rejection because of income. Rejection because of faith. Rejection because of race. Rejection because of the lack of faith. Rejection because somebody decided in their own ideology that they had a right, a false mandate to demean your humanity and my humanity. But I want you to know tonight that the stones that the builders rejected are the chief cornerstones in building a new America. I want you to know tonight that when the rejected get together, we can redeem America from hate and from discrimination. I want you to know tonight that when hands that once picked cotton join Latino hands, and they join progressive white hands, and they join faith hands, and labor hands, and Asian hands, and Native Americans hands, and poor hands, and then we join gay hands and straight hands, when we all get together, the rejected can cause something powerful. I know, brothers and sisters, gay and straight, transgender and lesbian, I know the power of coming together. I know it biblically. I know when Moses and his people came together, that Pharaoh came down and the Red Sea opened up. When Esther and her uncle Mordecai came together, they were able to stop the plots of destruction against the Jewish people. When David and five stones came together, he was able to knock Goliath down. And the headline in the Jerusalem Morning Herald read, the next day, the bigger they come, the harder they fall. I know that when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stayed together in the fiery furnace, God come to fire down. I know what it's like biblically when we come together. But I also know historically during slavery, it looked like justice had lost. But when Harriet Tubman and Frederick Douglass and some Quakers and some white abolitionists got together, they formed a fusion movement that brought about the end of slavery. Women didn't have the right to vote, but when Sojourner Truth and Elizabeth Cady Stanton got together, they won the right to vote. Plessy versus Ferguson looked like it had the victory. But when Thurgood Marshall got white lawyers and black lawyers and Jewish lawyers together, an all-white Supreme Court with one member who had been a former KKK had to vote unanimously to tear separate but equal down. It looked like Jim Crow had beaten down justice, and justice couldn't rise again. But when Rosa Parks and Martin King and Bayard Rustin, who was gay, together with Viola Wusa, and James Reed, and so many others, Fannie Lou Hamer, when they got together, they tore down Jim Crow. I know biblically what happens when we get together. I know historically what happens when we get together. But I also know that if people are doing all of this to fight us, then they must be afraid of us coming together. And that means we gotta fight. We gotta fight hard, because we must be some bad somebodies if they gotta do all of this just to win. I know it biblically, I know it historically, but I need to be vulnerable with you tonight. Several years ago, the doctor said I'd never walk again. He said I'd never get out of a wheelchair. And like many of you, I felt rejected. How you gonna preach without your legs? All my life, my legs had worked. All my life, I could depend on them. I was 30 years old, and I woke up one morning and I couldn't move. I spent 3 months in a hospital bed, not knowing if I'd ever be able to ambulate again without a wheelchair or walker. But I'm here to tell you, over those 12 years, somehow, my mind got together. And then my doctors and my nurses got together. My swim coach and some therapists got together. My children got together. They helped me with my legs and they helped me move my legs. My church got together. The elders in the church got together. My prayer warriors got together. And then my faith got together. And when they all got together, I started walking again. I might walk with a limp, but I can jump now. I can march now. I can stand now. Because I've learned that when we all get together, there is a power when we come together. And so together, let's ensure that hope and not hate has the last word in America. Together, let's ensure that all of God's children are respected and treated with dignity. Together, let's make sure that the rejected redeem the heart of America and make this nation live out its promise. Together, let us come together until we are one nation under God, indivisible, 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 with liberty and justice for all. Let us come together. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, this is no time to fight alone. Let us come together. Stand on your feet if you will. Grab somebody by the hand. I need 20 people to run up here right now. I don't care who you are, trans, I don't care who you are. Run up here right now. I want to show America something. Black or white, run up here right now. If you've known rejection, but you will not stay isolated, you will not stay bound down, you will not break. Together, somebody shout, together. Somebody get my left hand, together. Together. We will not give up on America. Together,
together,
we will restore the heart of America. Together,
together,
we will break down racism. Together,
together,
we will break down homophobia. Together,
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 we will stand against this administration. Together,
together,
we will fight for health care for all. Together,
together,
we will keep on until
until
we are one nation.
One nation.
God bless your hearts tonight. God bless you.